Good evening, guys. For joining us on this evening for the talk about building web applications and React framework. So myself, Chaitanya, I work as a full stack developer at DBS. So I started as a mobile developer. I eventually became a full stack developer and have a good experience on Spring framework and React.js frameworks. Let us start with one sentence from the Venkat. Once he told in a talk, he told there are a bunch of guys, they wanted to add some cool new features to Java. They started doing that and finally they called it as a Kotlin. Here is a fun fact. As Java name is named after an island from the Indonesia, Kotlin is also named after an island near to St. Petersburg. So before I want to start my talk, I want to highlight some major events that are happened in the Kotlin history. Kotlin project started in 2011 from JetBrains, and they open sourced it in 2012, and the first version released in 2016. And 2017 was like a golden era for Kotlin, where Spring also given its support through by releasing Spring Framework version 5.0. And then Google announced it that they are going to support Kotlin as a programming language for mobile application development. And then Kotlin announced multi-platform plugin through which you can share the code between two different worlds like Java and JavaScript. Then in 2018, the asynchronous programming support also came into Kotlin. In 2019, Google made it as a preferred language for mobile application development, Android application development. And in 2020, Kotlin Hyderabad group started, and here we are today sharing the our knowledge on this platform. So the agenda of this talk is to have a brief discussion on what is DSL, then the Kotlin HTML DSL, and then I'll start a demo on how to use Kotlin HTML DSL and how to use React.js framework with Kotlin. So prerequisite for this talk is you have to have a knowledge on Kotlin, JavaScript, and React.js. Even you don't have a knowledge on them, just try to listen to the talk so that if you feel interested and if you dig through these concepts little bit more, and in the future the dots may become line. So what is the DSL? As per the Martin Fowler, this is the definition. DSLs are small languages focused on a particular aspect of a software system. See, for example, take CSS and SQL. CSS is confined to a particular area of area where it will helpful for you to beautify the web pages, and SQL, if you consider, it will helpful for you to query the database. If you consider Java is a general purpose language. You can build any kind of application through the Java. This is a difference between a normal general purpose language and a DSL. DSL means domain specific language. If you go further, there are two types of DSLs. One is external DSL, another is internal DSL. External DSLs are those built from the scratch. If you want to build an external DSL, right from the lexical analysis to code running part, you have to do on your own, and everything will be with you only. I mean, the flexibility is with you. However, you want to make the language to be that in such a way you can design. Whereas internal DSLs are confined to a host language. It always depends on the host language API, and the flexibility part depends on the host language. Kotlin has good support for internal DSLs. If you go with Kotlin internal DSL, there are three building blocks for the Kotlin internal DSL. One is Lambda expressions. Number two is Lambda expressions with receivers, and three is extension functions. These three are the building blocks for Kotlin internal DSL. If I start talking about these three, it will take another session. So for now, I'll continue to HTML DSL for now. So what is HTML DSL? Kotlin actually gave good support for HTML language, and they gave some HTML DSL. Generally, how you write HTML tags is like this, but with Kotlin DSL, you're going to write like this. The people who knows Kotlin, they might have guessed already what it is. This is actually a lambda function. Then if you want to have a division with attributes, then we will write like this. In Kotlin, you are going to write like this. And if you want to have internally another tag inside the HTML, generally you write like this. But in Kotlin, you are going to write like this. So, I'll start demo now. Till this point, do you have any doubts? You can ask me. You have any questions?
Is it just a wrapper kind of thing around HTML?
Sorry?
Is it just a transformation kind of language from Kotlin language to HTML? Is it just like that or something more?
No, Shanti. Actually, Kotlin has given wrappers on everything. It's a DSL. You can also create your own DSL to solve a particular problem. They have given this DSL to solve the HTML problems. So some people may feel like HTML is not readable. So with this, you can make it as a readable. See, for example, there will be a div. This div will have attributes like that.
Okay, fine.
You can also define your own DSL.
Can we conveniently call DSLs as just wrappers, like which internally is calling something a general purpose? Can that be an understanding? What I mean to say is, you said Java is a general purpose language, right?
Yeah.
And we make DSLs so that they are specific to a domain.
Yeah, yeah.
So just to clarify my understanding, can I call a DSL just a wrapper which internally use a general purpose language and does things?
Yeah, generally, it is something like that only. DSL will be defined by using the general purpose languages API. See here, if you take the DSL, HTML DSL, all the Kotlin will give you three different things like lambda expressions with receivers.
Okay.
Using them only, you will build the DSL.
Okay, so somebody internally should be translating that to HTML, right?
In our case, it is Kotlin JS plugin.
Okay, awesome. Okay.
So generally, to create a Node.js application, we use npm. For example, if you want to create an application using Node, you'll use npm install. React.js gives you one CLI command through which it will set up all the things by default, right? So generally, we use npm install, and then we will do with that. But without npm install, directly you can call the React CLI without installing it. So the command is npx create react kotlin hyphen app and kotlin demo. This is the name of the app that I'm giving. So this npx command will fetch the create react kotlin CLI, and it will install it directly.
This npx is related to npm?
Yes, it is related to npm.
Okay. This is official npm CLI or?
This is official npm CLI only.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is the difference between npm and npx?
generally in an if you see for example, if you want to use create React Kotlin app, you first you have to do npm install globally using hyphen.
Okay.
Then you'll you do like create a hyphen React hyphen Kotlin app and Kotlin demo.
Correct.
Without the first here with the npx, you are eliminating the first step.
All right. Okay. Thanks.
Okay, let us see. Now we can open this directly into IntelliJ using this id command. IntelliJ will take this folder automatically and it will convert into project. So if you see here in the readme file, it will all the things will be mentioned, how to start the application, everything. To start our application, we have npm start. IntelliJ has already built-in support for npm. Okay, let the indexing. Okay, let us start the application. You see here it is impaling the code. It will take a little bit of time to start for the first time. You can see the app with the three different content and running. Here, the general structure will be like this, but I don't want all these things. I want my own things. I just went away deleting all this stuff. Okay. So if you see here, this is the main component from where all the components will be called. Generally, if you see, the React framework is built with all the components concept only. Now let if you can see the errors on changing a small thing also the compiler we have live reload and it will automatically compiled and it will be visible on the screen. So let us make our first component. I'm not following any file structure. I'm just creating the components. This is only a demo purpose. Generally, when you are doing, you can follow all the file structure, like you can make all the components in a single folder, like that. I want to create. Hi Prashant, do you want to talk anything?
No. Actually, it's got.
Okay.
You carry on.
Yeah. First, I want to create a component with the name app header. Create. Generally, in the React, if you are using JS, it will be app header.js. As we are using Kotlin, it will be app header.pt. So the component, how component will be like this. Class. We'll start with the class app header. The class will always extends React component, R component. R component will have two parameters, that is R props, R state. I and then we'll have a default constructor. As we are extending our component, we have to implement its methods. It will have one method, that is a render method, which will be called by default when the component is getting loaded. There is a life cycle that if you go through the React framework, then you'll understand how this render method will be called. Here we can have our HTML. As we are using HTML DSL, we will not have an actual HTML. We'll have a HTML DSL code. Here I'm going to use div. All these are from React library, DOM library. If you want to write a text, you have to write inside like this. With a plus, you have to start and then you have to write the text. In the demo, I want to build a dashboard which will show you the current corona cases in India and some of the states of India. So if you write like this, the basic component is ready, but you have to export this component to be used in the other components. So how do we export? Generally in JavaScript there are other things like named exports, all these things, but in Kotlin you are going to do this with you're going to create an extension function to the R builder and equal to, you're going to call chd, and to this you have to pass class name. So if you create like this, this component will be exported and it will be open to be used in other files. So here in the main component, you just call it like this. That's it. The component will be imported. As we have a good support from IntelliJ, everything will be imported automatically. And if you see in the browser, will be loaded. I think it is compiling. Yeah, it is compiling. Once compiling completes, things will be automatically loaded. See, you can see the app component getting loaded. Now we'll proceed with the second component. I am going to create a body component. So what my idea is, inside the body we are going to, first we will show the number of cases from India. To do that, we have to call a backend API. I already have an API that is running in the Heroku. I'll call that. So I'll create like this. So inside this, I want another component so that the component will take the name of the country as an input and it will display the number of cases from the component. So how do I do that is I'll just create another component. First props. So in React, how do we pass an input to a component? There are two ways. One is using props, another is using state. So to define the props, you have to do like this. Interface, app section, props. Of they are going to extend R props. These all are wrappers on React framework provided by Kotlin. Kotlin wrappers. You have a there is a project with the name Kotlin wrappers. They are giving wrappers on React.js, Vue framework, all these things. You can go through that if you want further information. So this is so we will create like this, and we have to have some parameters to be declared here. Where name of the page. Suggest a string, and you have to pass this here. So when you are having props, you have to do little bit more ceremony. Just a minute, guys. To have an extension function. To this extension function, actually we have to pass some receivers so that it will receive the props. To do that, we have to declare like this, and we have to pass the props dot. These are of type React element. Then you have to return the child object. Child. This handler will act as a receiver. Okay. Need to pass props here. Also, you have to have a default constructor here. Constructor with receiving props. So this app is ready, this component is ready to take the input from the props now. So on rendering we have to do so when we receive a prop, we have to call API. So the as per the React lifecycle, the component there is a method called component did mount. Inside it you actually call the API calls. Generally there is another method called component will mount, which will be called first. There is a good argument goes on, but React in the from 16.3 dot onwards the component will mount has been deprecated and in the favor of hooks. So now the way is to call the APIs is component did mount. What it will do is first it will render your component with the default values, then it will call the API. So to call API, we have to have another library, that is Axios library. So how do we do that? We have to import it with the npm install first. npm install Axios hyphen hyphen save. This hyphen hyphen save will save your dependencies in the package.json. Sorry, I given wrong spelling. This is the correct one. Actually, if you see here, Axios is a JS module. It's not at all belong to Kotlin. So in this case, how we call an external module into the Kotlin language? We have to do like this. First, we'll create an file. So it's an external module, right? So we have to call, we can call it by using JS module annotation. Inside it, we will pass our library name. The external is the keyword specifies that it is from external, and it will give you any response of type T, Axios. It's a method name through which in future we are going to call this module, and you have to, this method, it will take some config object. This I will This method always returns a promise because it is used for API calling. Here's response of P. So there are a few types we have to declare. I'm just putting them. So these are actually the types we have to declare for the Axios. Next. We will create a script. Inside it, we are. You see my API. Just a minute, guys. This is running on Heroku free version. If any request doesn't comes to it, it will sleep for after 10 minutes. Have a little bit patience, guys. So meanwhile, I'll write the response type. Response. So the actually we have to define a Pojo class to handle the response. In Kotlin, we will write Pojos like this using data class keyword. It is something, if you read about Java 14, it is something similar to records like this. So here inside it, we will declare what are the fields that are there for us. These fields should exactly match the API. These should be separated by commas. So now again I'll write another function which will help us to call the APIs. Okay. I'll take the country name as a string input. Country name will be always string, right? And it is going to return a promise. This promise of type axios response, and that also axios response also will be of type place response. Then we will return axios. We have to have a config object. The config object will be like this: JS object. This API, we have to declare API URL. Post name. Then the API URL will be like this. These are and these I'm writing as lambda expression to take country name as input. You're going to pass country name. So with this the country, we can get the data from the API. Now inside the app section, when you receive an a prop, you'll call like this: get props dot name of the place. Once you receive the prop and you will call it, then we will after receiving the response, we have to update the state of the component. To update the state of the component, first we need to declare the state of the component. That is also same like how we declare props. Here I am going to have a response where this is of type place response. So once this is done, you have to mention it here so that the component will be of type app props under sec a common state. Now once you receive the data, you will have a response variable. Then once you receive response, we have to update the state. This set state is a method from the React framework, and Kotlin provided a wrapper around it to update the state. Now how do we update the state dot response is equal to response dot data. This is how we update the state. Once we receive the data from the API, and we will set it to state like this. So once we received the data and we set it to API, then we have to display the data. So to do that, first we have to do like this: if state dot response is not equal to null, this will prevent us from the undefined object as well. Once we get like this, inside it we'll have a p, and name state dot response dot name of the place. Next we will be having that's state of response dot number of deaths. Next, we have confirmed cases. So this is how we will do that, and then we will call the app section. So we have to pass the country name using name of the place para, name of the place equal to India. So to this point, guys, anybody having any doubt?
No.
Hello. Wait a minute. Sorry, I forgot to declare at one. Yes, we will get recording of this session. Once it compiles, you can see the okay, we got something problem 404. Okay, this API got a week, right? This has to be initialized with the data. This is a problem with free hosting. Now it is fed with the data. So you can see here now the number of cases in India and record cases and deaths. Now you see, if you want to have cases for another country, it is just simple. Just app section, name of the place. Let it be compiled. Now you can see the number of cases from US as well. So this is how we define the components in the React with the state and props. Now let us move on to the next section, like using a React DOM and also using some I'll have a some more demo on using CSS as well. So till this point, anybody having any doubts, you can ask me. Okay, I'll take it as no. Okay. Now, first I want to start with a bootstrap. I want to make it a little bit, make it good, feel good. Install bootstrap. So to import Bootstrap library into your app, in the index.css, you have to import like this. Import /./././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././././. Oh, I think the wrong library got installed. Yeah. bootstrap.js. Now to make now first we'll start with header. To make it look clean, we will have some classes to give bootstrap classes. So this is how we define attributes to a division. And when you are specifying multiple classes, you have to use set of method so that it will all the attributes will go as a set. We have to have nav bar. These all are required classes for a nav bar. So if you see here, the navbar become very neat, neatly styled with the bootstrap classes. You can see all the classes that are applied here. If you inspect element, yeah, this is how. Now inside this, I want to have a one more element to have. Take the inputs from the user. So and what my idea is, we will have a one search option there. On clicking on search, you will be presented with the input box. And on the input, if you type the country name, you will get the number of cases from the country. Okay. So, inside it, then attributes class is equal to set of inside it. Another, you'll have a li. Sorry, li. That's equal to item. This should be go as a set. For now, I'll keep it as a normal text. Now you can see the search option I've got here. Once it is done, now we need to have a React DOM to navigate it to a different component on click of it. So how do we do that? We need to install two new libraries. Give me 1 second, guys. So the library names will be like this. This is actually a wrapper around the React DOM library. And you need to install React DOM as well. React router. Once this is done, we have to define the routes like this. What I will do is I'll send these two components to a new component. Index. We have to define routes now. Okay. Yes, actually there is a problem with the latest version of the libraries React router, DOM and React DOM wrappers. Give me 1 second. I'll give the version. So these are the versions which these are the versions right now you have to use for using React Router DOM. Now this browser router is like the component which is a wrapper around the history object of the browser. We have to have a switch inside it. We will define routes. This is a default route. We have to keep exact equal to true for the default routes. then inside it we will call app object. So also runs a route with search as it comes. Then we have to redirect it to search component. Now, as of now, we don't have search component. Now we'll do that. First we have to pass props, then app state, now inside it we will have an input button. To input we have to pass some of the attributes like of type, input type we need to have a input type text, then we will have a placeholder. Enter the country name. Okay. So in React.js, when we are taking an input from the user to store it, we have to use a state. So I'm going to define the state for this component. So this is a var input text, this is of type string. Now when anything, when user enters some text, we have to take the text as input and we have to store it in the state. To do that we have a function called onChange function. OnChange function is a lambda expression. It will give us event object, and then we have to, we can delegate it to another method, handle on change of event. Let me create the method. So when we are taking the value event dot target as input element. So as is the keyword to do typecasting in the Kotlin, it is equal to doing like this in Java. Sorry. Okay. Now I want to react to the user input only when its value is greater than 2 characters. Greater than or equal to 2. Sometimes if user enters US is only two letters, right? So I get like greater than or equal to, and I want to use get country data by target dot value dot then once I get receive the response, I have to update the state set state. Set state state dot okay, I have to have another response the place response equal to response dot I just renamed the variable as it is. Okay. Next, once we receive the data and set the state, then we have to display the result, right? So for that, we can use like this. Span. Set the span. Spot name of the piece. Same way I want to have another four tags. Total number of tags. Form. Number of confirm. Recover. Number of record. All these things should happen only when the data is in the state. So I have to have a null condition here. State dot search response is not equal to null. Okay. Now I just has to copy this. Yeah. There's one more thing I have to do in the header. Yeah. Nav link. Last name. This is also another way. These are the props that you have to pass to navlink. So if you see here, the app is compiling. Once the app compiles, it will load. There are some errors. Let's see. Okay. Sometimes apps libraries will not load properly, then what we have to do is we have to cut the app and stop, kill the app and restart it again. See here now, if I click on this, you'll get an input. Then I'll type like, yeah. See, now you are getting the data also. Number of deaths, confirmed, recovered, everything. So in such, we are not seeing the header. To get the header, we have to call header component here. Header. Now we will get header also here. So to this point, everything is good. Now, guys, anybody having any doubt here? Okay, I'll take this as no. Now I'll move on to applying CSS. So to apply CSS, Kotlin actually, Kotlin wrappers has given good wrappers. People there are two ways to apply CSS. One is you can create a CSS file like how this index.kt and index.css are exist. This is the way how you create an external CSS. Sometimes the guys from React framework, they may see, know that style component framework. Style components will allow you to have a CSS styles inside the components, inside the JS itself. The same way, Kotlin also given an API wrappers around the style components. We can use them. And we can inside the stuff, our KT file itself, we can apply the styles. So to that, to apply the, to use them, we have to install them first. I'm going to install the three libraries at a time. npm install ri jetbrains. Copy paste is not on. And you have to have a inline style flexer, prefixer. Then you have to have a styled components as well. And I can save. It will allow us to save in the package.json. Yes, all the libraries got installed now. I need to run one more command again so that this command will allow sufficient libraries to be able to detected by IntelliJ for the auto completing purpose. Now I want to define the styles. How do I define internal styles like this? Instead of div, we are going to use style div. So internal to this div, we are going to have, there will be another CSS handler. So in this, we are going to have like this pad. Well, first I'll define margin. All these imports are from CSS library that we have installed right now. Okay, I'll go to PX. This is how you have to use your PX. I mean, these are generally in CSS, we'll define like 10 PX like that, but we have to have like this 10.PX. PX is an enum from CSS library. Okay.
I please mute.
On floor rating is, sir.
Hello, can you please mute?
So, okay. So when I want to define the margin into in all directions, this is how I will define. Next, I'll also define some padding. This is also same way, all 5.px. Okay. And now I want to display. If you see here, the data is coming and displaying in a side by side only, right? Now I want to make them to display in the column order. To make that, we have a display equal to display flex and flex direction. So call. Give it a second, it is compiling. Okay, again I have to kill the app and restart it again as I installed new libraries. Once the dev server starts, app will be loaded. Okay. See how neatly displayed the data. And if you see the applied CSS, the class names will be automatically generated by the Kotlin, and the whatever you apply, all these things comes here. So if you want to see, this is the way if you want to define pixel, and if you want to say in terms of percentage, then you will have to use PCT. the percentage is also got applied. You can see that in the CSS. Margin is 5% now. So this is how you can use CSS, guys. With this, my demo is over. So this, if you want to reach out to me, you can reach out to me through these mediums. Thank you very much, guys, for joining the session.